Would you really warm me in the light of day? The very same man show flows right through my face.
Mitt navn er Linn Gjerstad, jeg med I programkomiteen til mediedagene. Jeg skal bare gi bittelitt sånn praktisk informasjon først, for vi har fått en avlysning I dag, en sesjon med Rachel Beth Anderson, som skulle være klokken 2 I klokkeklang. Der får vi en erstatning, og det rapport fra et lukket land. Hør historien om til journalisten som fikk tilgang, der ingen andre slipper inn. TV2s Bent Skjerstad og Pål Skåtun forteller om sitt opphold I Nordkorea, og det altså klokken 2 I klokkeklang. Men nå... han the bureau chief of BBC's Innovation Mobile Bureau and the head of the BBC Innovation Lab. Please welcome Matt Danzico.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah, so I want to talk to you about a couple different ideas today. But first, I'm going to start with this guy, which is BBC Pop-Up. To give you an idea, BBC Pop-Up, what it is a bunch of different things. It's BBC's first mobile bureau, right? It was a mobile bureau full of video journalists that relocated to a new city every 30 days, right? So I was the bureau chief of this mobile bureau, and basically we started in Boulder, Colorado. We went to Baton Rouge, Louisiana. We went to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, the United States, and Tacoma, Washington. We started in London, so we were working at headquarters of the BBC in London, and we came to the United States to launch this thing. And so this was just an experiment, right, to see if we could crowdsource our stories. So what's happening here in this video screen, basically we went around to each city and when we would arrive, we'd ask people to come out, meet us, and tell us what stories they wanted us to cover, and then we'd make feature stories and documentaries about their ideas. So basically we were acting as the conduit through which people were able to tell their stories to the world, to our global audience. The stories went out on BBC World News and News Channel in the UK, which combined is in somewhere around the order of, I think, 500 million households. So it was a huge program. And so basically what we also did beyond all this is we also taught free journalism classes. We did sort of, we ran a Skillshare in London, so we carried that idea with us and we went to universities and taught free journalism classes. However, so I am here not to tell you about what I have done and what this thing is all about exactly, but rather I think it's more interesting because you can look all this stuff up online, but it's more interesting to talk about why. So why did we do this, right? So that's what I want to talk to you about today. But first I'll just tell you, so my name is Matt Danzico. I have been with the BBC for about 5 years. I started in breaking news. I've been sort of all over the place. I worked for the website. I helped launch some of the US websites that they have. But I'm American. Surprise, there are some Americans who work for the BBC. There's a couple of us. I'm a journalist, I'm a filmmaker, I'm bureau chief of the BBC Mobile Bureau, and I'm the head of the Video Innovation Lab, which is sort of the most important part. This is the Video Innovation Lab of the BBC. So this is a collection of crazy miscreants. Basically, it's a bunch of journalists. It's radio producers from BBC World Service, television producers from BBC World News TV. We have hackers. We have software engineers that we found in the streets of Amsterdam. We have collected, basically amassed, a very strange group of people and put them all together to see what they would create. And who did this is this guy, the guy second from the right there on the top. That's James Montgomery. He's a controller of digital for Global News for the BBC and probably one of the smartest men I have ever met. And so this all said, this is what we do. So what we do is we rapidly prototype new programming. We're what you would call a spaghetti team. We basically get paid to throw spaghetti at the wall and see if it sticks. And 9 times out of 10, it fails miserably, actually. And that's okay, because we learn quite a lot. But what we do is we rapidly prototype new programming to help solve ideas or solve problems that the BBC is facing. So for instance, I'll go into this a bit more in depth later, but we created the BBC's first Instagram account, which is not really a novel idea, but 2 years ago it was. And so we started pulling raw feeds from South Sudan, from Syria, raw footage that we were getting in from our journalists and putting it on Instagram within a matter of hours. Things start to get really interesting when supposed napalm hits a school in Syria and nobody knows about but the BBC, and then we put it out on Instagram in a matter of 4 hours. Things start to get very interesting. So we also built this guy, which is the BBC bot. It's just basically a piece of software we did up in JavaScript. And with that, we created this guy, which is the BBC subreddit. We have free classes that we teach. We create text explainers for mobile phones. And we created BBC Trending and BBC Pop-Up, which is pretty much what I want to talk about today. But first, so how this all happened. So BBC is a legacy institution. We all know this. I was working in startups before I came to the BBC. I was really sort of hesitant at the beginning, but this guy, 2 years ago, asked me, how are we going to bring BBC video to new digital audiences? And this is not a unique idea or a unique question to the BBC, I don't think. But together, we basically decided that we want to go to them. So we, the BBC, needed to go to you. We have, you know, a ton of television stations, a ton of radio networks. Instead of asking you to come to us or come to our website even, which is pretty much an archaic idea, in my opinion, we wanted to start to go to you. And so the reason being is that we needed to find out where our audiences were, right? And so we found out that our audiences aren't on mobile. So in the US, this data is taken from fall of last year. So these numbers are probably even higher now. And so mobile usage in the United States, 60% of mobile usage, or US internet use, sorry, makes up, or mobile usage makes up 60% of US internet usage. And then web usage makes up just 14% of that on mobile phones. So the question is, what in the world are people doing on mobile phones if they're not using the web? Well, they're using different applications, right, that use the internet. We saw this with Chris Anderson in his famous Wired issue about the rise of the internet. But the CEO of this analytics firm basically said it really well, and she said that a single application, or that a browser is just a single application swimming in a sea of other apps, right? And that's very, very true. And so we took that idea and we ran with it, and we said, basically, let's go inside spaces that people actually inhabit on their mobiles and attempt to create content from within them. It is my view that the development of the internet and sort of our movements on it is very similar to the clustering of people at the dawn of civilization, right? So we have the development of metropolises around the dawn of civilization. We have people clustering around resources. And so we can say the same thing about the development of the internet, where people are clustering, right, around resources. Basically, you know, you have the Tokyos, the New Yorks, the Parises of the world, and people clustering around the resources there, and you have the BBC putting up physical bureaus around these spots. And so we wanted to take that idea and adapt it to the internet. And so we wanted to colonize, or help colonize, the emerging digital metropolises, you could say. So as I said, the Londons, the New Yorks, and the Tokyos have been developed, but and the Bergens, maybe more like the Oslos, but they have been created, and they've been created on the internet, and they're called Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Reddit, and it's our duty to start to help colonize those spaces as a content creator. So in the world of mobile, you could say that Facebook is New York, and maybe the web is like San Antonio, Texas, or someplace like that. So it's important for us to go where the people are. And the people are not necessarily just on the World Wide Web. So you kind of can start to see our line of thinking here. That's why it's imperative for us to start to create content within these spaces that people are inhabiting. And so that's why we went to Instagram, and that's why we went to Reddit. So I explained the Instagram account. What this is we created a bot. If you're familiar with IFTTT or IFTTT, basically it's a piece of reversing software that can take in feeds from different places on the internet, reformat it to fit other spaces online, right? So this guy, this is just a visual representation of the bot. Basically, what it can do is it can take in feeds from BBC World News, from World Service, from the RSS feeds of the BBC News website, and it could throw it out on Kick, which is something that we do. We have half a million followers on Line, which is a chat application in Japan. We have moved on to Kakao Talk, which is a chat application in Korea. You know, and so we've moved on to Reddit. This is an automated subreddit. So our website is being republished onto Reddit automatically without us having to do anything. So this bot allows us to do that. So this is what we were doing. And all was well and good, and things were going along very, very well. But then somebody came to us and we're like, and they said, guys, we want you to create a program that's about the internet, made for the internet, specifically social spaces on the internet. And we thought they were crazy, and we could never do it because we're the BBC. But the first thing I did is I gathered a bunch of people inside a BBC World Service studio, and I made them do the Harlem Shake to start to get used to like how silly the internet could be. I thought this was an important idea to take all those beautiful World Service producers and make them do this inside the studio. This guy is crazy. So this is BBC trending in a very weird way. This is a good representation of it. So this is the same studio where you're listening to very, very serious reports about things happening around the globe. And instead, what you're seeing is the Harlem Shake, the Penguin Dance, twerking, a bunch of amalgamation of 1,000 different internet dances all happening at once. And so basically, the BBC trending, what it is it's a program that tries to do the journalism behind the trending topics on the internet. You know, there's 1,000 space, physical spaces that the BBC is reporting in, and so now it's our job to start to branch out into all the digital spaces where we're moving around and having ideas. And so that's what we did. So the program has created 250 videos or somewhere around there by this point. It's been around for like a year and a couple months. We've gathered millions of web views from our video. That's the result of us embedding it in interesting places in the internet. It just won a Webby Award last week. We've only been around a year, which is really cool. It was for social news and information. That was what the award was for. So yeah, so far so good. Basically the idea behind this program, this by the way is BBC Trending, which is also a collection of very, very forward-thinking journalists from within the BBC. Some of them are old ex-BBC World Service people and BBC World News Television. But let's just look at this. All right. So this is the phrase R4Bia. We basically, how we create stories is we pull up social analytics tools and we attempt to plot out the data points related to specific phrases that might be trending on the internet. R4Bia was a phrase that was being used in relation to the protests happening in Egypt about a year and a half ago. It was basically, there was a bunch of people in Cairo holding up their fingers in protest to government forces like that. And R4Bia was the phrase linked to this hand gesture. This is me just pulling up some of the data related to it. But what we would do is we would look at phrases and uses of trends whereby if we saw a phrase about to trend and about to bell curve, about to skyrocket, we would hit it at the beginning. We would attempt to hit it about here, and then we would do a story about that. We would do the journalism behind R4Bia. In this specific story, we found the person who created the phrase, and we found the person who created the hand gesture is actually from a work of art. And we found them in Cairo using sort of the BBC resources that we have. And we literally went and found them in Cairo, right? And so we do the same thing, like Taylor Swift. I don't think we've ever actually done a story about Taylor Swift, but this gives you an idea of the peaks and valleys that even things like Taylor Swift or Yodo, which is you only die once, will have. You know, Yodo is actually a counter to YOLO. So you don't have to YOLO, you could Yodo, if you so choose, I guess. So this is the idea behind BBC Trending. So I'm going to play you an example of a report that we would do. Keep in mind, what we're doing here is we're doing content about the internet, about social media specifically, and we're trying to put these bits of content inside these social spaces that people inhabit. We are going to the people instead of asking them to come to us. This video was embedded in every single social network, a piece of social media that you could possibly imagine. And ones in very remote places around the globe, right? And so what this is the day Mandela died, or was pronounced dead. I basically hopped on minutes after he was pronounced dead in South Africa, and I scraped Twitter. I pulled together all the data, or all the tweets, that had gone out in the previous 60 seconds before he was pronounced dead. And I wanted to show Twitter a mere reflection of itself before the world knew, before the world knew that he had passed. And because there were rumors flying that he had died. And so this is what you're about to see. Oh, hold on 1 second.
We've interrupted this program. The South African President, Jacob Zuma, is making an important announcement.
Mandela, founding president of our democratic nation, has departed.
Right, so that obviously is a very heavy story, but I think it's a beautiful reflection on what people were feeling back then. It was a mirror image of Twitter. We just held up a mirror to the whole of Twitter and we said, this is how you were feeling. And that video was actually the most watched video related to Mandela's death that we had. It trended a top slot on the BBC World News website. And that's a very strange idea when you think about the fact that the people were turning to the BBC to find this story. And this is what the world wanted to see. Quite strange. So, we do other stories. This is a video about a woman dressed in black walking across the whole of the United States. Kind of a lighter story, but we went and physically found her. This is a video about that.
She's
and about
woman,
people's
she's
fears related to that.
She's all by herself out here. And it's like, wow, you know, that takes a lot of courage to do.
Every time we hear
But I'm going to click through because I want to tell you, more importantly, I want to get to BBC pop-up again. So, what we found from BBC training, what we learned from all of this, is that we saw 3 times the amount of video views on BBC trending feature videos than we did on normal feature videos. So what we think is happening, what we thought was happening, was that we were throwing our story into that bell curve, into that upward trend of a meme, and we were throwing our story in there and helping to evolve the narrative of that trend. And so our story, we were doing the journalism behind these trends, and it was helping, or we hope it was helping to evolve that narrative. And so as a result of people, we're banking off of people's enthusiasm about an idea, basically. And so we did that, and everything was all well and good, and we thought, okay, there's another series. We staffed it, all was cool, we moved on. And then we thought about this. What if we took this idea of creating content within and for emerging communities, and we apply that idea to the real world? What in the world does that look like? And so what we think that looks like is this, is BBC Pop-Up. So BBC Pop-Up is a program where, again, we wanted to go to the people rather than asking them to come to us. And we did that in a physical way this time. So we created the first experimental mobile bureau that had us, again, relocating as a unit every 30 days around the United States. We were on the road for 197 days. I just got off the road 4 weeks ago. I actually haven't been home since. I haven't been home since August of last year. I'm exhausted. but my backpack there, I've been living out of that backpack for a really long time. So if I smell later, if we talk later, I apologize. But yes, so this is BBC Pop-Up, right? And basically, what happened was we decided to do this, and we decided to just try something. We weren't going to tell anybody we were launching this program except for internally within the BBC. And instead, we would just have a BBC announcer on BBC World News and News Channel. And of course, we coded the internet with this video and all over the place. And we would just let this play. So all of a sudden, what you would see on BBC World News is someone would say, and now we have something special for you to watch. And this played.
Here is an illustrated summary of the news. It'll be followed by the latest film of events and happenings at home and abroad.
Switch out, region, switch out.
This is the BBC television service.
Be on the air again at the advertised time. Until then, goodbye, everybody.
So we released this video, right? And we didn't tell anybody about it. And basically, the whole of the internet and the television world came back to us and said, "What the hell? Like, what are you doing?" And that is exactly the response that we wanted. We immediately, without even having made a report yet, we got press from The Guardian to journalism watchdogs like Nieman Lab and journalism.co.uk, a bunch of others, and they basically said the BBC is about to do something really strange. And they were totally right. This is kind of what we did. So basically what we did, again, to be clear, we went around to different cities, and when we would arrive, we'd ask people to come out and meet us. We would buy pizza, stacks of pizzas, and we'd set up shop at a university or a newspaper, and we'd say, come tell us what stories you want us to tell the world about. And so this is literally what's happening right here. And we'd film the events. They were town meetings or meetups. And then we would do, we'd make feature stories about their ideas to our, you know, half a billion audience on television and to all the people that watch the content on the website in all these different social spaces. We were uploading our content directly to these spaces online. But in addition to that, we were playing our videos on the sides of buildings within the towns. We were offering our video content, raw footage, up to city council members, up to local government officials. We were literally trying to provide a service to the town. We were providing record of what some of these issues that they were experiencing were. And in addition, we were teaching free journalism classes. This is Jack Garland, who's a video journalist who covers conflict. This is him teaching students about what it's like to be in a firefight in South Sudan. We had some really huge heavyweights participating in this BBC project. I mean, it wasn't just sort of a bunch of video journalists who are quite young. We had like Alistair Leithhead, who's been a conflict journalist for 30 years. I mean, the man has seen Rwanda, you know. But then we also did stuff like this, where we went into the town and we volunteered. We were sitting in the middle of the town. We had apartments, houses. We were local journalists. Our car, our huge BBC ridiculous-looking car, was parked outside. People would leave us notes on the window telling us what ideas they wanted us to cover. This is Ben. He is not a zombie, but he is dressed as a zombie for a haunted house that he participated in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. The makeup is insane. He actually looks like a zombie. I kind of can't believe it. But anyway, so we would send these flyers. This is the flyer that we would send to the university. When we wanted to go to a new city, we would ring up a university. We'd say, hey, we're the BBC. Can we commandeer one of your rooms at a university, maybe in the journalism department, for one evening sometime next month? And they would say, who are you? And we'd say, the BBC, you know, we want to come there, blah, blah, blah. And we would explain what we were doing. And then we'd say, as payment to you, we'll teach free classes at your university to the journalism department throughout the whole month, if you're willing to put up this flyer around your campus and then go into the town and legally put up the flyer around the town. And they said, okay, if you're willing to teach classes, sure. And basically what happened was this. We would arrive in a town, and then we would come out with our cameras. The three of us would come out there, and we'd create this video.
The coast, what's happening with the coast, that also has to do with privatization. The Louisiana government is always pandering to like these huge corporations. A lot of them are outside. It's really disservicing Louisianans because it's not sustainable. So what's gonna happen in 50 years? No one's thinking about that. They're privatizing sectors, though, like, you know, education, healthcare. A lot of places consider those things human rights.
I'm interested, really, in the South, how we view discipline and punishment differently than the rest of the nation.
When you went out in the yard and you were said, you know, go get a switch, take the leaves off, bring it back in, and that's how you were disciplined if you really had done something bad.
Switches, maybe not so much, but maybe the use of like a leather belt or something of this sort is definitely used.
So, drugs and obesity, is that right?
Human trafficking, we're like what, one of the top 10 cities for human trafficking is Baton Rouge. And I feel like it's very undercover, like it's swept under the rug way too much.
A large art community here, it's growing. More students are now taking photography and art majors, not because it's the easy way out, but because it's something that they actually want to do.
There's a lot of children there that was put through the foster care system at a young age, and they have rations there, but it's never enough. It's crazy how malnourished those children are.
Football is huge in the South, and like the culture of college football is huge in the South, and like, why is that so important to people down here as compared to anywhere else?
So not many people know, but there's like a gigantic swampy sinkhole like to the west of Baton Rouge.
Right here.
Coastal wetlands loss. We're losing, our coastal wetlands are literally sinking into the ocean. We're losing a football-sized area of land in an hour.
Yeah, that was brilliant, thank you.
So a really intense video, right? So what's interesting about that video is at one point in time you saw a bunch of post-it notes on a wall. Okay, so those post-it notes represent what the community wants journalists to do stories about, not what journalists want journalists to do stories about. And so if we started to question if journalism really is this public service that at least the BBC thinks that it is, why in the world is the public not involved at the point of story conception? You know, we argue in the BBC, I'm sure I've done it in 1,000 organizations, about what the style of our stories should look like, what place we should put them out on, you know, like what platform, you know, how it should be filmed. Nobody ever argues about how the story was conceived in the first place, you know? Like, I think journalism is at the point where we could start to be a bit smarter about the very content of the stories to begin with. And so what we found was quite interesting. And that is that in these places that we would go to, Southern Louisiana, Pittsburgh, Boulder, Colorado, if big media had been there before we had arrived, they had done stories on A, B, and C, whereas the public was suggesting D, E, and F. Literally, the story suggestions were completely different than the stories that were being done by large media in these places. Except for the coastal wetlands loss that you just saw, that was an example of a story that had been done. There's an amazing article about it in Newsweek before our arrival. So that was the one. But other than that, I mean, there's a huge disconnect here between what the community sees as really important to tell the world about and what journalism sees, right? And so we did not expect this, basically. But we realized it was happening during the second day of our entire 197-day journey. This is Boulder, Colorado. So this was our first attempt at creating a town meeting, right? And so I should say that we don't just do town meetings at universities, though. We've done them in public supermarkets where people are buying produce, and we sort of tap them on the shoulder. We're like, I know you're buying an apple right now, but would you tell me what's troubling you in your town? And so here, we had like 25 people come out, and they were telling us what stories they want us to do. But we had already been preparing to do the story on the legalization of marijuana. Why? Because that New York Times journalist had just gotten super stoned and wrote that feature article about being stoned, right? So we were like, obviously, this is an issue, you know? New York Times is doing it. And everybody was doing it. The BBC was doing it. Like, everybody was doing this story. But these are the people who live in that community. And we said, you know, why aren't you telling us to do the story of the legalization of marijuana? And they said, why would you do that? It works fine. It's a non-issue here. So why would you do that story? And we were like, well, everybody else is doing that story. We are doing that story. Like, everybody's doing that story. They're like, yeah, we know. You're perpetuating a negative image of our community. It's a non-issue. Nobody cares. Get over it, you know? And we found that time and time again. What story did they want us to do? They wanted us to do the story of how the housing bubble was happening in Boulder, Colorado, and forcing out the middle class and the lower classes because of how high housing prices related to the fact that you couldn't expand into the green space outside of Boulder. There was a bubble, quite literally. So, uh, So we saw this again in Tucson, Arizona, illegal immigration. Obviously a story that we're going to do. Nobody suggested it. Tacoma, Washington, second biggest port in the United States. The dock worker strike was hitting really hard on the West Coast by the time we arrived in Tacoma in February. Nobody even knew a dock worker in Tacoma, Washington. They were saying, we don't even know who these people are. You know, you should not do that story here if you're covering this community. You know, so we're finding some really, really, really interesting data related to that. So this video is, we're not just doing feature stories though. This video, I think, yeah. So this video is basically a story that the community wanted us to do. So they said, don't do the dock worker strike in Tacoma, Washington. Instead, you need to do a story about glass blowing. We thought, one of three people recommended that we do a story on glass blowing in Tacoma, Washington. We said, what in the world are you talking about? They said, well, the Crips are here. The gang, you know, two of the largest gangs in America are the Bloods and the Crips. They said, the Crips are here, and then the Hilltop neighborhood, but the neighborhood's being saved recently by these random people in the community pulling youth out and teaching them how to blow glass. Like, so instead of spending nights on the corner, there's cars going around to these kids hanging out in gangs on the streets, and they're pulling them into these cars and teaching them how to blow glass. No, not even joking. So we created this as a result.
Some people have told me that this was one of the most dangerous street corners in America just 25 years ago.
And they had little kids on bicycles, and the bicycles would roll up, get the drugs, and come up to the passenger window, drop it off, get the money.
Guns and drugs, violence. Hilltop is like Crip territory.
So was it a hard neighborhood to grow up?
Yes, it was very hard.
The people who had the power to make sure that this area was supported didn't support it enough.
So the question is, how has the community healed?
Well, some went to jail, others just moved away, but a few turned to an ancient Roman art form.
Glass blowing's extraordinary. There was an artist, Kathy Kaparik, and she used to cruise in her car and pick up kids off corners who were hanging out at night saying, hey, you want to come blow glass?
It gave me hope, because when I was 16 and breaking into middle schools, I didn't know what I was going to be doing the next year or 5 years from then.
They gave me a life. Yeah, that's how simple as I can put it.
We're gonna roll down to 9th. My mom, back in 1984, opened a uniform store to supply uniforms to both of the major hospitals, which are on either side, sort of Hilltop. Where the cash register was, I had a one-way glass, and I got to see taverns down there. Any given night, there was probably 100 crack dealers out there. I mean, it was just nuts. I'm at the point of mental combustion,
stuck in this rut. The wild scene in Tacoma ends with two men shot and a police officer in a scary wreck.
Gang warfare exploded. So you can see where this is headed, right? So let me leave it there for right now. And let me say that we operate as one-man band. So while I'm doing that story, Ben, who's the guy in the black shirt, is doing an entirely different story that somebody suggested. Anna, who was this rotating VJ who's coming in and out of the crew, was doing another story entirely. You know, and so we operate as one-man bands. There's no producer, there's no reporter. We are the reporters. How I filmed that, I asked somebody walking down the street, can you hold the camera really quick? Okay, I'm from BBC, this, I swear to God, just to hold it right there, yeah? Okay, so what's happening behind me? We're in the most dangerous street corner in America right now. And I say, oh, thank you very much. All right, have a good day, bye-bye, you know? It's like, we're doing everything ourselves. You know, we're all trained mostly, like, we all started in photography. So why everything looks like an art doc is because it kind of is. So we're, you know, it's photography by training, videography by choice, and journalism by profession. Maybe that's kind of like the tier. But what we found is when we release these videos, we put them in spaces, we hand them off to the government, we would hand them to the city, we'd play them on walls, we put them in social spaces on community threads, we would embed our videos there. We literally had somebody, we hired somebody during the last 2 months to figure out smart places to put our video content on the internet. And then, it would go up on the BBC website. But as a result of all of this, what we were seeing is nearly five times the amount of views that a traditional feature video would get with some of the pieces, not all. We definitely failed a huge amount of the time, a huge amount. But the videos that did well saw about 5 times the amount of views. And that's because when we looked at the data, the whole of the towns in the towns, the states were watching these videos, right? We literally had somehow managed to penetrate these online communities and these different threads that somehow got these videos going in different social circles. I'll show you a video in just a second. Let me just say that the output that we created during those 6 stops in a half a year was 57 independent videos. There's about 40 full-on mini documentaries, 7 half-hour television shows. So these videos that we're creating are being being enclosed within a half-hour program at the end of the month. It was a monthly program called BBC Pop-Up. And then we created a bunch of blog posts, a couple thousand tweets. We taught 18 journalism classes. And basically, we created content for those half hours where we showed behind the scenes of how we were creating it. Because we weren't sure what we're doing. We're never sure what we're doing at the Video Innovation Lab, to be completely honest with you. We're just experimenting. And we wanted to show the audience that we were experimenting. So here's a clip of a behind-the-scenes clip that would go in between some of the stories during that half hour. So I'll show you a formula of how we create the half hours in a second. But this is a behind-the-scenes clip after I drank like 5 cups of coffee or something like that. All right, we don't have much time, but let me show you how we've been getting around America during the past 6 months. That there is Ben. This is Ben's computer that he sometimes edits on. In the back seat, we have another camera here. We have another makeshift editing studio. Here is our virtual reality glasses. I'm not sure why they're there. My girlfriend gave us a bunch of plants that we hung there. Here's a camera bag. Here's a camera bag. There's the mysterious back seat that's back there. Nobody goes back there. There are a couple skateboards, multiple soccer balls, a baseball bat. This is America after all. Some running sneakers and a wetsuit for all of your surfing needs. And that is the BBC pop-up car. So that car right now is parked in my parents' driveway in Pennsylvania, which is a much longer story. But that car, we would edit out of that car. That was our home, right? So we were sleeping in the apartments in city centers and like in communities where people were living in these towns. But that car, we would edit in there because we wanted people to pass by the car and do this. You know, what is the BBC doing here and just knocking our window? The amount of stories that we got by people knocking on our car window while we were editing was amazing. And then we would invite people into our car to hang out with us and just talk about what issues were concerning them in their towns. And that's what we did in every single place that we went to. And so this was the formula that I was talking about. So basically, we would create about 6 stories per month. We didn't sleep pretty much for a half a year. It was an exercise in sleep deprivation also. But we created 3 different stories that we'd use for the half hour at least. And then that behind the scenes footage would be like this. And so what we'd do is in our Final Cut Pro, we use Final Cut Pro to edit this thing together. We would create an intro video that would be the first thing that you would see in the half hour. And that would be released online after we created it. Then we would create behind the scenes clip. And that would be released online after we created it. And then we would do story 1, released online, story 2, story 3, so on and so forth. And then basically at the end of the month, we would just drag and drop these clips into our timeline, export it, and that would run on television. And that was our month in like Tacoma, Washington, or wherever, or Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. What we also did is we tried to engage in 1,000 different ways. Again, when we were releasing BBC Pop-Up, we did have secret accounts in various places. Like, for instance, there was a Tumblr account where I was showing sketches of my notebook of, like, we designed everything. Like, the journalists, we designed the logo, the car, everything. And so this was the first time I ever sketched out the BBC Pop-Up logo in my notebook, and I just put that on Tumblr. And so people were commenting on Tumblr being like, what is this exactly? We don't understand. And we wanted to build that hype before we set off. And so we had BBC World, a Twitter account, and Facebook account releasing tweets that just looked like this, that just said something big is coming, and this is BBC Pop-Up. You know, this account has 10 million followers, you know, and our social media accounts didn't fare as well because we mostly concentrated mostly on the World News account and the UK account. And then this is the flyer again. We let the community decide. We let the internet decide where we're going next sometimes, so that's why we went to Pittsburgh. Because on Tumblr, people wanted us to go there. We would then tweet out where we were working at any given time and say, hey, come say hi to us. We would love to talk to you. And so the idea was to just engage in any way possible. Some bits of it worked and some bits of it didn't, but we learned a lesson. And so, you know, again, what's happening here is we're just getting our content and getting ourselves out to the people. You know, much in the same way that, you know, we were going into new spaces on social media through our Instagram account, through BBC Trending. That's what's happening with BBC Pop-Up. And so that's why we created it. And this story.
People in Pittsburgh love Pittsburgh. They love this city. They're known for their Yinzer accent.
We don't say downtown, it's downtown.
Downtown.
I say Warsh instead of Wash. It's just the way I talk, I mean.
I'll let this play for a second.
The website Gawker put together a poll to figure out what city in America has the worst accent, and Pittsburgh won.
One of the problems with it is the local people who speak those accents are working class people.
I don't know, I don't think we have the ugliest accent.
I mean, could you see why some feel that this poll was classist? Can you see that?
Sure, of course.
But this just isn't a story about Pittsburgh. Other Pennsylvania cities have been getting slammed, poll after poll, study after study for years.
Who did this survey? Who participated?
I'm happy in Scranton.
I love our area.
I don't see the efficacy in all of these, you know, these polls and rating places, especially if you're just some jerk who's using the city as a punchline.
So basically, this is a story that we did on the fact that Gawker had put together a bracket claiming that people from Pennsylvania, or from Pittsburgh specifically, had the ugliest accents in America. So yeah, it was really funny until you start to think about the fact that, well, why is that? Well, it's mainly blue-collar people who have that accent in Pittsburgh, and Pittsburgh does have a huge blue-collar population, and those people aren't all white. So they ended up being quite a racist and classist bracket and thing for Gawker, in my opinion, to do. And so we the people of Pittsburgh wanted us to do this story. This is the story that they kept asking us to do, not some of the stories that we had done, the BBC had done in Pittsburgh before, or the New York Times or CNN or anybody. And so we did this sort of thinking we have no idea how this is going to go. We did this story, and basically this video did so well that this was the number one most watched video on the BBC website for an entire week. When we looked at the data, we couldn't believe it, because even when I finished this video, I thought this isn't very good. But when we looked at the data, it looked like the whole of Pennsylvania had seen this video. So what we had done is basically we decided to try to bring in a blogger from Pittsburgh who runs a blog called I Heart Pittsburgh. She has a Twitter following, a social media following that's bigger than any newspaper in the city. And it's just this woman named Lindsay Campbell, who we eventually hired, actually, to run the social media for our team. And she basically just ran with the story and promoted it for us, basically. And that's sort of how we growth hacked the idea of being in Pittsburgh and doing this story. And so, you know, this is another example. And then we offered up the video and raw footage and everything that we found to the people of Pittsburgh. And this is another example of us going to the people. And so that's my main thesis, I guess, for this presentation, is just go to the people. You know, they tend to know best. And I guess I'll just play the end of the BBC pop-up episode. I'm not sure if we have that much time, but it's only a minute. And that will conclude my talk and BBC pop-up, I guess, because this is the last stop, really, on the entire six-month journey. And I'm going to go to sleep immediately after this presentation. let me turn on sound. Sound would be helpful. Again, sleep deprivation is just, it's terrible.
Well, it hurts me very much to say this, but I think that could be the end of BBC Pop-Up. We filmed our last film.
Some people have been telling us about a non-profit group that teaches youth about leadership through skateboarding.
And this is the end of our six-month road trip.
We've actually lived in six different states across America, and we've put thousands of miles on our trusty steed. I would hope by now that our families, our friends, somebody would be wondering where we are exactly right now.
We'd hope so, but probably not. So along the way, we managed to film, edit, and produce dozens of stories, and we even found time to teach from local universities and work at local newspapers.
Not to mention we've become friends with countless neighbors we've had all across America. Thank you so much.
Sorry, it's okay.
It's okay.
What are you guys up to today?
Okay, so we're at the edge of the United States. We're in the far northwest corner, and we've run out of room. So there's only one place left to go. That place.
We're going to Canada. Ben, let's go get us some bum bags and become normal tourists.
And so that was BBC Pop-Up, a somewhat novel idea wrapped in sort of an entertaining program. And that's it.